Welcome all to this session today. And before we start with the science of psychometrics and understanding of the various aspects relating to the assessments that we'll be deploying with our participants in the group or through our through our services, your services to the participants or students coming to you, must understand what the utility is all about, the standards of the utility and the total, complete understanding of how we could go ahead with the science of understanding it. Before that, let me tell you an important thing that is pertaining towards the more intricate issues like of the admission or with the count various streams that you did yesterday. Last week you understood the various functions, how the students can be guided through various streams in the various areas that they will be pursuing after 12th. You also understood in a certain contextual way how the counseling setting is deployed, how an engagement is done with the counselee, and how you engage on various levels, while from not only being empathetic but also building trust, and then also knowing what is their objective in going through the counseling and guiding them towards the right goal or the right path, setting up their goal. For in that context, you as an individual also must possess certain qualities, certain attributes, certain traits, certain competencies, so that you are able to deploy it very effectively as a tool, as a service provider towards the student that you are engaging with. In that regards, we also did a small assessment for you. The name of the assessment was Acharya Lakshanai. Acharya Lakshanai pertains to the core area of the methods Kshetrabodh that we talked about. Understanding the circumspective the circumspective analysis of the area that you will be pursuing or the student will be leading towards, the understanding of own self through his abilities and interest, and then putting it towards the user, like how you will be able to put it as a goal for them. So this analysis of self as a counselor was also done through the Acharya Lakshanai test, which we'll discuss in detail after we understand the context of psychometrics in our area. What we'll do today is I'll run you through the core understanding of psychometrics in the next half an hour to 45 minutes with answering some of your questions. And then you will be creating your account on the portal. So we'll do it immediately with you all people getting a hands-on experience on creating your own account and getting 10 assessment licenses onto your dashboard, and we'll be also demonstrating how to use the dashboard for you. So this is the total agenda today. After we close session today, you'll be able to deploy a couple of assessments to your near and dear ones today. We'll discuss them as a case studies tomorrow in the tomorrow's session. So this is in a nutshell about the next 2 hours. So let's start. What do you understand by psychometrics? What has been a very, deeper level understanding of the idea that started as early as 20th century, early part of 20th century, when Alfred Binet came up with the first intelligence assessment in 1905. Mind you, the idea of assessment was not new to people around. Psychology itself got a status of science in middle of the century, in the middle of 20th century. Before that, it was considered to be more philosophical in origin, rather more spiritual in nature. We Indians also today perceive psychology as one of the subsidiaries of our ecosystem, which we connected together with the spiritual sciences. You know that today is World Happiness Day, and I wish you a very happy Happiness Day today. But really speaking, are we that happy? Are we that, in a state of more explicit well-being that we will want to have? And the answer to this question is we are not. As a nation, we are not. As an individual, we may be, but then as a nation, we are not. As a nation, most of our population falls in a scale of 1.8 to 2.3 in a point of, on a 10-point scale on the World Happiness Index, which is like, if you rank it, it's like 144th among 155 nations on the top, bottom 10, 11, compared to Yemen, compared to Venezuela, compared to Vietnam, or compared to Syria, we run those League of Nations. So, but we should start looking as a psychology, as a distinct way or a science which enables us to explore it more empirically, more objectively. And in that context, psychometrics was one of the forerunners in that area, as an area of psychology, because it gave us a lot of objectivity in measurement of mental processes and capacities. Now, as I said, this idea was not new. You know, this idea prevailed as early as 20th century, the beginning of the 20th century. But that time, it was very difficult to get it noticed as far as what we are measuring. It's an intangible dynamic aspect of, you know, human capacity, of human brain, of human nature, of human behavior that we are measuring. And this far more, you know, gets into complications, because you will have to have a reproducibility of the results as far as science is considered. So a very systematic way or a branch has to be developed. And since then, everybody is making some of the other advances. And now, a century later, we are very, very advanced in this area. I can tell you certain very monumental examples that have been deployed in the world scenario, in the world context, in the global context, that have been their underpinnings or roots in psychometrics. Take a case of the famous election that was won by none other than American President Donald Trump in the year 2016. And that was driven by one of the leading psychometric assessment companies from UK by the name Cambridge Analytica. It used a very complex algorithm of decoding personality and demographic personality or inclination of an individual through demographic benchmarking of the responses of the individual. Through that, and towards the you know, couple of years later, or maybe a year later, how the what happened? Someone exited. Okay. Anyways, what happened a year later was the United Kingdom went away from the European Union, and again the same organization by the name Cambridge Analytica helped it through sway the opinions of the entire British community towards getting into Brexit. And this was done solely with using the benchmarking, or maybe the data analytics, or maybe the core psychometric principles that helped you to map the persona. Now, this is the impact. This is the level of impact how psychometrics can be viewed for. Since I say it is as big as like influencing a nation's mood, it is also as, you know, evident from the fact that almost every organizational and educational setting in modern India, or maybe the modern world, has been deploying psychometrics as one of the tools for better results or better predictability. Take for a case of the SAT or GRE, the examinations used for admissions for graduate and undergraduate programs in United Kingdom or United States per se, they're all based on the science of psychometrics. Similarly, Indian organizations and universities have been employing psychometrics for over a decade now, and this percentage is only going higher and higher. Having said that, what are these psychometric tests all about? What are these tests? What do we call psychometric tests? So any questionnaire cannot be a psychometric assessment. Mind you, keep this in mind. So if you write down a questionnaire and say that this is a psychometric test, it does not work that way. It has to go through a very series of, standardization procedures which will make it a psychometric test. What are those? We'll look forward in our understanding. What are those tools and what are those methods that make a questionnaire a psychometric test? But basically, there are two major variants. Let's focus on those. What are these? These are objective and unbiased set of questions that are reliable in a way of assessing the candidate. The assessors present the candidates with a set of questions to answer, and now the question comes, to you is what type of questions are these? So there are two broad classifications. One is a personality assessment or a personality test. The other is an aptitude or ability. The one is an attitude related concept, measurement of attitude of the individual, the personality of the individual, and the other is a more aptitude or ability driven assessment, which together, independently can be called as psychometric assessment. They can club together, they can be used independently. All these combinations can go up, but these are the broad classification of psychometric tests that you see. So how there are facets of human natures you must understand, and why I'm saying you this is because this is what we'll be measuring. If you look at gross totality, like how the facets of human nature come up, is you always see this cognition and affection are two components of human psychology. So what is affection? Affection is your feelings, affect. We call this as it's a very traditional Greek way of looking towards it. It's like affect. They call it as affect. It's your feelings, it's your emotions that has bearing on the individual and then the external environment that the user goes through. And then there is something called as cognition. So affection and cognition, roughly we say at the head and the mind, or the head and the heart complex, but it's not a heart thing, it's a mind thing that people talk about. So it's cognition. So cognition is thinking, learning, motivation, pattern recognition, or say these things which are relating to complex logical frameworks of human mind or human brain. These are cognitive things, whereas the other part is the affective part, which is more or less relating to your emotions and which tend to drive your behavior or the personality or the attitude, that you can say. So you have roughly the affective and the cognitive part of human behavior and human nature coming to play. The next thing that you go along while you are growing up in your life is whatever thing you acquire on the way vis-a-vis to your development and growth in your life, which is relating to the knowledge that you gain through the atmosphere, through the environment, through the surrounding that you're living in, the experience that you gather out of it, the way you have been nurturing it into your bosom. And the next important thing is the skills that you acquired while you're working on your job. These are very typical to the occupational setting or the contextual setting that you are into. So if you roughly categorize the nature of human existence, it is more towards cognitive, affective, and acquired. I hope you've understanding this. Smriti, Maitri, Ishika, hello? Yeah, great. So having known this, someone has entered the room. Who's this? Gargi? Just a minute. Huh? Yeah. May I know who's Gargi, please? Hello?
Hello, sir, I'm Vrinda.
Oh, Vrinda. I was a little misplaced. Anyway.
That's my sister's name, yeah.
Okay, great. So we've understood the facets of human nature, and I hope we are pretty clear. Is the pace okay? Are you able to get into the nitty-gritties clearly?
Okay.
Fine. So let's move on to the next thing. So you must understand the science behind psychometrics, as I said. So what we are actually able to see with quantifiable scientific measurements is that these are obvious things. For example, if you're looking to weigh someone's weight, you'll see it, you'll be able to quantify it. If you're able to weigh someone's height, you're able to see it. It's an obvious thing. It's not a dynamic thing or maybe an unobvious or maybe unseen characteristics that you're looking at. Some of the unseen things also you can quantify. You know, there are quantifiable measures for pressure. There are quantifiable measures for temperature. These are dynamic quantities, although these are not the things that you catch up in your hand or you handle it or manipulate it through your actions. But these are still things that are present and they affect the physical environment of ours. In physics, these are quantifiable, very much tangible, very much measurable. You can feel the difference. There is a temperature change, a gradient change in the temperature. You can feel it and you can measure it. There's a change in the pressure. You can feel it, you can measure it. But in human brain or human mind per se, there are two types of, you know, areas that largely are classified into the conscious or subconscious parts of the mind. The conscious are more discernible, treatlier, the more visible cultural elements that you see, either you experience it or you understand it through the level of interaction through your colleagues, your peers, your friends, your relatives. You understand it. So you see the person is looking to me and he's angry. It's an observable thing, right? The person is sitting quiet in the room and is sad. More experienced, more obvious part expressed through your behavior. It's obvious, it's conscious. It's an objectively observable thing. You can look at someone's face and say he's happy. Okay, you cannot say, you per se will say he's very happy, less happy, you know, moderately happy. That is also possible. So what are the challenges with the mental measurements is there is an indiscernible trait layer. The very trait or the very constructs of human mind, which are, you know, running undercurrent to your expression, which are silent drivers, I would say. It's like these actually are the most potential drivers of your expressions or behavior, but are mostly covered with the veil of your conscious expression. Look, I'll give you an analogy for that. Look at a very heavily flowing river, a very strong, you know, river with huge basin, you know, the river basin. And it is flowing end to end. Look at the flow, look at the magnanimity of it, look at the strength, and you'll see with the force it's flowing, you rarely observe the kind of turbulence at the surface. You know, it's flowing smooth with the force, but look at the undercurrent. The river in its core has a lot of turbulence happening, but it's not very obvious on the surface most of the times. So that is the strength. This turbulence actually leads to further, journey of the river with a lot of force and a lot of vigor. While in human nature, you also find this underneath, the indiscernible, the non-obvious, the hidden, the unveiled part, the veiled part, which is more towards driving the external, the veiled, the unveiled, the more obvious part is the real difference maker. And we often miss this out. So you often find people laughing. Beneath it, there is a lot of unhappiness or challenges that the individual is facing. That is quite obvious in our society that people hide their true things, and that is why it is called as personality, the persona, mask. The indiscernible way of, how your inner atmosphere is all about. In the more context that we are talking about right now, because we are talking about the ability and the personality of the student, This is also possible that the individual is not aware of the potential that he or she has got. And for that reason, you must have deployed a very valid way of measurement to measure those unquantifiable things. Now, if you want to measure a particular vocational interest of a student, you must have a very strong tool to measure it. Suppose I give an example. I hope I'm making some sense to people. Hello? Someone respond? Yeah, great. So having a very strong a way of measurement, you must have a very strong tool for it. For example, if you do measure weight, what will you use? What will you use to measure the weight? Tell me.
Weighing scale.
Weighing scale, absolutely. You'll be using weighing scale. And will you be using a stature meter to weigh a weight of an individual? Stature meter is the way by the instrument that we measure the height. It's not, right? So it's not the stature meter that is, the instrument should be measuring that what it intends to measure. Similarly, if you want to measure certain skills of an individual, say for example, you have to measure the aptitudes, the verbal skill of an individual. How do you do that? You'll have to use that tool only that will measure the verbal ability, and not a tool which will be ending up measuring something called as numerical ability. It'll be a very wrong way of using it. So this is why when you see the measurement has to be done of something that is what is not obvious. First of all, the obvious and the unobvious, maybe the obvious part you'll be able to look and understand from the individual, but the unobvious thing which is not revealed to anybody in front of the individual, you'll have to measure that, and there has to be a tool which has to be valid, reliable. So this is one of the ways of understanding. So what are these? You will clearly look at the, it's like an iceberg. You know, it's a phenomena that usually we find in the description of mental paradigm. You see the entire visible cultural or visible elements of your behavior or your actions and the structures and the methods and the ethics and the principles that you play around, which are more visible to everybody. It's above the surface. But the larger section, a larger portion of that entire, entire being, which is invisible, which is the driver, but it is hidden below the surface. These are your motives, instincts, drives, your deeply embedded thoughts, your beliefs, which are in the core, which drive. Let me give an example here how this works. You know, you may find it very tricky, but it's a definitive way of looking to it. And it's, if you look at it from that perspective, you'll come to know how you will be able to help the individual to change that way the thoughts and the emotions are surfaced on the visible cultural part. So consider, I hope you are there. You all are there. Attentive and all. Completely.
Yes, sir.
Absolutely.
Yes, sir.
Okay, I'm asking you a question. Let me see everybody, please. Great. So we've seen this, the obvious part and the unobvious part. You know, that what is revealed and that what is not revealed. Now we're looking at the science of psychometrics here. And then we want to also help the individual to correct his challenges, what he or she is going through. Let's understand with a small analogy, a small way of applying it to ourselves in the first place. So you all have thoughts, right? How are thoughts formed? Do you have an understanding? General understanding, not talking from the psychology perspective. Tell me how thoughts come to you. What is your understanding of thought coming to you? And this will help you to also get engaged with the individual. Tell me how thoughts come to you. Anybody? Anybody? Okay. through experiences. Okay, Maitri is saying thoughts comes to us through experience. Now let's understand. I'll tell you how you really. We don't want to get to the source of the thought per se. We want to understand the process of getting the thought. We're not very sure about the source of the thought that comes to us. We may only say that it comes through our intellect or our mind. Where it comes into that is what we're not very interested in as of now. We're just trying to understand the process of how thoughts are churned into your mind and how you can have a very distinct way of changing the way your thoughts getting. For example, let's consider negative thoughts. You all get negative thoughts. You all get thoughts which are unnecessary. You all get thoughts which are very, very unproductive. And you say a lot of time of yours is wasted on thoughts which are not very relevant to the task or, you know, life that you are engaging at that point of time. So how do we change that? And we really don't know what are the methods and process for that. So let's understand. A bubble emerging from the bottom of a lake or a water body, it comes up, right? It comes up and it surfaces on the water body and it bursts. So it's coming from the source below and bursting on the top of it. This is a classical analogy given in how thoughts surface. You don't know really how the air entered the water body, but when it's there, it has to resurface and come up and burst. Now, what happens typically is, consider this coming up, these air-filled bubbles coming up, and they're coming up constantly, and they're coming up with the same pattern and shapes and things. Now you are fed up with that because these are negative. You feel that these are thoughts, and you feeling like these are negative thoughts. What really happens is you'll have to look at these thoughts, and when they surface, they come to your. You don't have a control when they start emerging, but when you start experiencing those, someone said experiencing thoughts. You start experiencing those thoughts. There you have the control. There you have the control whether to experience it or pack it and throw it in the bin or let it go or altogether resist it. These are the ways you can change. And these typically, while you find these are coming up, these form the tendencies. These tendencies ingrain and again come back through impressions in the subconscious. As I said, you see this image of the iceberg. At the bottom, these are impressions. This push the thoughts up, it comes up. And again, there's a cyclic process that happens. It turns into impression and then it comes up as a thought. It goes as a tendency. What you can do is you can mutate your tendencies here when they surface, when the thoughts come up, when they're transmitting into some kind of tendency, you can mutate them there by changing the way you're dealing with your thoughts. How you're going to do that? Either shunt them all together through your conscious experience, throw them in the bin, or this will happen 1, 2, 3 times that they will have, it'll work only for, you know, some period of time. The way you start building up this pattern of junking your thoughts, which are unwanted, it will turn into a tendency, which will in turn get into some kind of impression. And then the thoughts that will start emerging will be in positive nature. So this is a very simplistic understanding of how the churning of thoughts will come up. Why is it relevant here in this context? Why I'm telling you here is because if you understand the very nature of the subconscious and the conscious mind here, you'll be also not only able to objectively deploy your tools, but also interpret them in a better way. While a student is coming to you and is saying that I have an interest in, say, agriculture, and I have an interest in commerce, and then you are into groping in dark area, how can I find a commerce and agriculture occupation for him while he's also showing some abilities relating to the realistic, the abilities like, say, which are spatial or mechanical in nature. It's the complex interviewing of this interest and abilities that you'll be able to come up with some kind of insights for the student. That needs a complete understanding of his mind's thoughts, vocational personalities and everything. Once you've understood how this is happening with the individual, you'll come to a very curated way of, personalized way of counseling sessions for those students. This was an overview overall understanding of why you see these patterns are important. Now, if you've understood this, let's go to the next important aspect, and that is we'll just get into a nutshell of complete revision. We saw that psychometrics have two broad areas, aptitude and attitude, personality and ability, that we call. It measures the unobvious part and the obvious part, both of an individual, in a very quantifiable way, of an objective way of understanding. You've understood what is obvious and what is unobvious, what is discernible, what is indiscernible in that context. Now, how do you say that a particular test or a particular tool? Now, what is a tool you've understood? Like a series of questionnaires that is asked to an individual, and they have gone through some process which makes them standard. Any questionnaire cannot be a psychometric assessment. So what process makes them standard is more important. So let's understand. Norming, reliability, and validity of psychometric tests are the ways you find that these tests are made standard. What are those? We'll just have a quick look into it. Standardized testing could be composed of, for example, the questionnaire can have true false type of answers, multiple choice answers, authentic assessments or essays. There can be descriptive ways or a projective ways also. Of like, what are projective ways? Projective techniques are typical techniques which are not dependent on norm reference, but the individualistic interpretation of the assessor. So broadly, the norm reference assessments are, let me tell you an example here. Suppose I ask you, everybody, now I want an answer here. Don't like just mute yourself. I want an answer here. So someone's hemoglobin is, say, you are female, so I'm giving a female example. Some female hemoglobin is, say, 10. So is it high, low, normal, what?
Low.
Yes, Smriti, your response?
Not high.
It's not high. Is it low?
Yes.
Probably low. Okay, it's low. Anybody else? Ishika, you want to say something? Vrinda?
It's on the lower side.
It's on the lower side. So why is it low? Why is it low?
Because there is a range.
Must be between 10 to 12. Minimum should be 12, I think.
Okay. Why is it low? Again, I'm asking.
Because it's below the line.
Okay. Who set this line?
Doctors.
Acha. Which doctor?
I don't know.
So, how did you come to know that this is normal or abnormal?
Normally, in pathological test, it is mentioned
there's
that
a reference range,
should be the criteria.
If you understand how this reference range is derived, you'll come to know why is it like this way. So this reference, this is called as reference range, right? This is a reference. There is a reference study done for a population of that particular characteristic or that particular similar looking or similar categorized individuals. Say, for example, female. You're looking at female. Now, 10 for a female is low, and maybe 13 or 12 for female is normal, but 12 for male is low, right? Now, this, yes, again, the reference range change. Now tell me, 15 for infant is normal, high or low?
High.
Okay. Oh, for an infant, yeah, the normal hemoglobin level is 18 to 20. 15 for the infant, it is low. So you see, the variables change when you change the gender. The variables change when you change the age. So there is a difference when we apply different parameters or different norms to weigh a particular characteristic of an individual, the reference range change. Do you understand? So these are called norm referencing. So how do you say that a particular individual who is an individual, a lady from India, who is like 5 feet 1 inches in height, you know, tall, dwarf, or normal in height? Or maybe compare it to a lady from, say, Australia, which is like 5.1 in height. So geographically, you'll find there is a difference. Do you see? There, they will say that, no, she's like a little below height. In India, you'll find that Indian subcontinent per se, this isn't considered to be okay. You know, this isn't a normal and, you know, one of the average heights that we usually prescribe in this. So this is how the referencing is done, based on the age, gender, geography. And then there are various characteristics, various norms that can be attributed, and you can have the benchmarking of the data. These are called norm reference assessment. Now consider, I give you a word, a sentence, for example, I am. So Maitri, maybe Smriti, Ishika, Vrinda, everybody there, Purva, Shravani, Sarvesh, I tell you a word, I am. Write it in the chat box. Complete the sentence here. I am. Come on. I am. I am happy. Smriti is written, I am happy. Maitri is an, I am a human being. Okay. Vrinda is saying, I am kind. Servicing, I'm learning. Okay. Priyanka saying, I'm unwell. Someone else? Who's left in the list? I'm looking at it. Smriti has responded. Smriti, Maitri, Vrinda, Sarvesh, Priyanka. Shravani has put, I am a person better more than what I know. Okay. And then everybody's posted. Okay, fine. So what is it like, you know, if I have no standard answer for this. If all posted, I've just given you a sentence, a half sentence, and asked you to complete it. And then I'm looking at the responses. There is no unique or, you know, these are various responses that I've got. These are, maybe people are looking it from the state they are going through to the actions they are into, to the more you know, factual information that they are all about. So in that context, it depends on my interpretation or my wisdom. How do I take these statements to form an opinion or an understanding of your current or maybe your personality, for that matter, you are. So these are called as projective techniques. Projective technique is what? You project the way you are on a screen. So for example, you've seen the projectors, right? Now you see the screen and the projector. The projector throws a picture on the screen and it is, you know, imprinted on the screen, the picture. So this is not the nature of the screen. This is the projection that the projector is putting on the screen. So what is the nature of the screen? It's not the objects moving in the movie that is projected, right? It's independent of the projection. But sometimes you'll find that you get a fair idea. So hence it is called projective. It's like you're projecting something towards somewhere and you get an idea of how the screen is. This is not a very, very, you know, it's a very subjective way of looking at the personalities. It is used in clinical settings normally. The test like Rorschach-Ingvall test or say the sentence, the thematic appreciation test is one of the classical case of projective techniques, which is used in decoding the personalities of, you know, people also going into sensitive areas. What are subconscious derivations that we can get from the individual's way? So these are different type of assessments. So it's possible to shape any form of assessment into standardized assessment if it goes through certain way, certain method of, you know, standardization. When it comes to creation of psychometric assessments, questions are measured in scales. There are various scales. We'll look at the scales in a nutshell as we go ahead. And these are most often valid with standardization post-creation. So once you written the questionnaire, you go through data collection and you go through a sample of a series of standardization procedures, which are like, understanding the reliability, understanding the validity, and also the norming that happens, the non-referencing that happens. So these are the classical things. What is reliability, if you ask me? Reliability is a measure of a tool which will tell you whether this tool is dependable, internally consistent, which will lead you to a very uniformed way of understanding the things. For example, if there is incoherence in the measurement scale, because it's not a physical thing that you're taking, it's a series of questionnaires that are used. There has to be a coherence, a consistency in the questionnaire that is being put for the measurement. So that is what the dependability, the way you are able to rely on the tool itself is the reliability of the test. There is a coefficient to it, a statistical coefficient through which we can say that this tool is reliable. It has to go through the measurement criteria. The second thing is the validity part. The validity, in a simple terms, we can say, is the tool measuring that you want to measure? Is the tool measuring that what you want to measure? If you want to measure motivation, is it measuring motivation or ending up measuring the confidence? If you want to measure, say, science interest, is the tool measuring science interest or ending up measuring, say, the social science interest? So where is the tool focusing? You know, where it's directed to measure what? So that is the validity. It's a valid tool of measurement. That is how we call it, so valid. There are various types of validities. We won't go into that detail of understanding the validity, but by and large, you must understand there is a validity coefficient assigned to the test. Then there is importance of norming. As I said, there is a general fairness of test that is experienced through the importance of norming. So as I said, there is a norm group that you compare the entire data with. It's like you're comparing apples with apples. You don't compare apples with oranges in a very simplistic way. Do you understand? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Do you have any questions here, please? Everybody? Do you have any questions here? So it's a complex thing. We're getting into a little simplification here. How is a projective test interpreted by a psychologist? Doesn't his or her subjectivity affect her? Yes, absolutely, Sarvesh. In a projective test, there is a possibility of a subjective inference that may come up, definitely. Hence, you find most of the times in one of the fairness or maybe to get the fairness or the norming. So what is the other way of looking at norming is the fairness of the test. So to get the fairness of the test, you must have a very objective or empirical way of benchmarking the data, which is not easily available in the projective techniques. Projective techniques all the way help clinical diagnosis very well. You know, that is one of the best areas that you can have clinical diagnosis coming from. As far as the psychotic behavior of an individual is concerned, you can definitely have a projective view, and hence you need to be a very thoroughly specialized person in understanding the or interpreting the test altogether. The wisdom of an individual makes a very large impact on these assessments. I hope you I can answer that question, Sarvesh. Hello, Sarvesh. But since they lack the standard response, yes, finding of projective test are not empirical. Hence, you find it's very difficult. You find Rorschach is not used in a very, routine psychoeducational type of settings or a counseling setting. It is used only in a clinical setting where you find established deterrence or established deviation from the normal behavior going into some kind of psychotic behavior. They lack the standard responses, definitely. It's a very, very gray area of this particular thing. It has been very fruitful, as I said, in the clinical setting, but not in the way. I'll tell you a small example, Sarvesh, to just prove how it works. There's a famous experiment that you must all, maybe you can go through. The Rosenhan experiment, as it is called. This experiment was done by a psychiatrist where he sent 13 people, which were to psychiatric hospitals, 20 people, I suppose, to psychiatric hospitals in 13 psychiatric hospitals across United States. And they were actually normal people, including the psychiatrist himself. And they all were diagnosed as psychiatrically ill patient. They only presented one symptom. They can hear something, some extrasensory perception, like they can hear something, some noises or something. They were all diagnosed. Now they had to take a lot of efforts to get away from that hospitals because these psychiatric hospitals, they had this very strong understanding that they have a very strong diagnostic capacity of diagnosing psychiatrically ill patients. But this one psychiatrist, Rosenhan, I believe his name is. So he proved them all wrong. And he said, this entire system is flawed of diagnosing the psychiatrically ill patients. Then they challenged him that you send us the psychiatric patients and we'll tell you, we'll surely be sure that no people will be, misdiagnosed. So what he next time he did was, he sent 400 normal people, psychiatric people to all these clinics, and it turned out to be they were again misdiagnosing these people. Because you are not able to get through the rationals of like diagnosing a psychiatrically ill patient. It's a very flawed system. Hence, normally when you talk about non-reference assessments, it's very difficult to get through it. And when you see projective techniques, there are some help, but you also end up into some kind of challenges. This is a very gray area. I hope you understand, Sarvesh.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So if you've understood like what we were up to, then you must also know how we look at the, just a minute, give me a minute. Sorry, everybody, there was a call I had to attend. So having looked at the concepts of psychometrics, we also will want to know, give me a minute again. So looking at the very concepts of psychometrics, we land up into what really makes a psychometric tool reliable and valid. What are those coefficients that we should look for? And to answer your question, here is the answer. Look at this table here. You know, you see the coefficients relating to the reliability and validity of a psychometric test determine the quality of the psychometric test is, you know, prescribed here. So look at this, the coefficients up and above 8980 are excellent towards this, and you know, these are reliability coefficients, and the validity, it should be up and above like 0.35 to be highly beneficial or likely to be useful. Now any tool must satisfy this which you're using. If not satisfying this, you have a flawed tool in hand. What typically you come across in the parameters that have been worked out in the entire psychometric industry has to be weighed on these scales or these coefficients. So if you look at any tool, if you find the measurable data, ask for the manual, ask for the data of these particular tools, how they are, you know, calibrated. Once you've known that, you will be able to say that these are the reliable tools or valid tools to be used. You can depend on it. So this is how a psychometric test, you know, psychometrics behind any tool looks as. As far as when you're looking at WISPIS, we'll also understand what a WISPIS test is, what are those parameters that you are able to look for, and how you'll be able to take up with those parameters and the system that we have developed in the WISPIS assessments. Do you want to take a 5 minutes break? Sure. We'll take a 5 minutes break and then we'll come back again. It's 4:57. We'll join by 5:03. Okay. Great. Thank you.
very interesting reviews written in your assignment. It was a joy reading them. I hope you enjoyed doing the assignment.
Yes, ma'am. We were thinking about what to write. Means listening and observing that video was a different thing, and writing out and finding out something out of it was totally different experience. Means first time we have that point of view that, okay, we need to observe something.
Right. And it was nice to see you all attempting, all of which was covered in the first few sessions. I could, it's reflecting in your reviews. And I'm so glad that we are all on the same page when it comes to what the course has to offer. So let's hope that everything culminates into a good case study presentations in the following week. We plan to have live case study presentations and there'll be live supervision on those cases. In the interim, if there is anything that you come across, you know, you have any doubts related to that.
Hello, everybody. Welcome back. So, so what we'll be doing now is we'll be giving a demonstration. You all people will be logging in, creating your accounts on the portal, bizquiz.com. First thing, Purva will run you through the entire process. Gradually, you'll be also getting the first batch of assessments on your portal. You'll go through the process of using the portal, and she will explain you the report in detail. What are the outcome of the test? What we're going to do after that is, you all people, you yourself will be doing test today. After the session, 6 o'clock we'll conclude the session. You'll be sending the test link to you all yourself. Do the test yourself, go through that experience and see your report. Will you all do that? Great. So handing over to Purva. Purva, you there?
Yes, sir. Just give me 2 minutes. I'm starting the laptop.
Hello?
Hello?
Just a minute. Huh.
Hello? Can you hear me?
Yes, yes, I can hear you. Fine.
Yeah, in 5 minutes, I'm starting it, sir.
Yes, yes. So meanwhile, Priyanka, hello.
Yes.
So the process of this entire setting up the dashboard, they'll be registering and the explanation of the report will be taken up. They'll be taking the assessment today, and maybe in today's period or tomorrow, we'll have the case discussions happening. Tomorrow's 2 sessions, we'll have the case discussions happening. Fine.
Right.
Yeah. So over to you, Purva, and I'm closing. I'll be just there. Yeah. Fine.
Yeah.
Any queries here apart from this? Maitri, Smriti. Meanwhile, you can open up the window on your screen, www.vizquiz.com. I'm posting it here for your ready reference. .vizquiz. Until Purva opens it up, Purva will take it from here. Fine. Thank you. Thank you.
Yes. I'll be joining Priyanka, ma'am.
Yes, Purva.
I'll be joining from the laptop, so I'm signing off from here. I was on phone. So, like, in 2 minutes, I'll be joining again. Okay?
Okay, sure. No problem.
Yeah. Hello.
Hi, Purva.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Purva, I think Shruti has logged out due to poor network. Will you allow her in?
All right. I'll see if I can. Yeah. And Vrinda as well. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So.
Thank you so much.
Yeah. No problem. So first of all, I'll be sharing the screen, and we'll see how to log into the dashboard. Can you see the screen?
Yes, we can.
Yes.
Huh. So here, if you have gone to whizquiz.com, is everyone with me? Whizquiz.com?
Yes.
Yeah, there you need to click on the sign up button and go to corporate account. Sign up onto corporate account. Okay. I guess there's some net issue. Is anybody able to see the registration page?
No.
Okay, I guess
we can only see Google.
Yeah, there, I guess there's technological update. So I'll show you on how to sign up from the TradeFit. It is similar. So the process is similar, just we don't have to go to tradefit.com. This you will be doing on whizquiz.com itself. Okay. I'm showing you the process so that we can create our own WhizQuiz accounts. Okay. So when on the WhizQuiz site, when you go, you will have to go to corporate account and say sign up. This is the registration page will come over there for WhizQuiz. Okay.
Can you please repeat me, which page of WhizQuiz we have already opened? So we have selected sign up and corporate, but after that nothing is appearing.
Yeah, yeah. Actually, there is some issue with this. Just give me a minute.
Sure.
Yeah. Just a second.
After refreshing, I got the page, ma'am.
You got the page?
Yes.
Yeah, just a second. Even I got the page right now. I'll share the screen. Yes. I'm gonna hide this. Can I hide this? I don't know. I'll take it down. Anyways. Okay. Yeah. So, as I said, going to sign up, corporate account, say sign up. You will see the registration page. Is everyone with me? Yeah. Here you will have to put your name.
Excuse me.
Yes, you will have to.
Purva, I'm just able to.
Okay.
I'm just able to see what you're sharing. Otherwise, my I'm not able to exactly follow it. It still seems a little slow on my side. I'll try again though.
All right. Or else, what you can do, you can just write down the steps. I can go slow.
I got it.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah, thank you so much.
Yeah, so I'll go slow again. So when you go onto WhizQuiz site, there you have to go to sign up. And after sign up, go to corporate sign up. You will come to this page. Here you have to fill in your details. So say, Maitreyi.
I'm waiting for OTP, but from last 1 minute, I have not received any OTP.
You will receive, ma'am. I guess there's this.
Okay.
Yeah, you will receive. Not an issue.
Oh.
Okay. After mobile number, email address, you create your own password. Okay. Agree to terms and conditions. I am not a robot. And you will be able to sign in. So what I'll do is I'll create for myself. I'll show you. So I'll just check if I get my OTP. Maitreyi, have you got your OTP?
No, not yet.
Okay. Just a second. I'll give it from the back end.
Okay, I got it.
Yeah, I got it too. Yes.
So even I got it.
So you
okay, now I got 2-3 OTPs at a time. So which one to enter?
The latest one.
Okay.
Yeah. 7-1. OTP failed.
Yeah, done.
I got registered.
Great. I'll just show you what to do then. Yeah. This is the thank you for registration page. So you got this message?
No,
yes. Yes.
Unable to click on sign in means I'm trying, but I think it is taking time.
Okay. So, Maitreyi, you can just write down the steps. I'll go ahead. Is it fine?
Okay. Perfect.
Yeah. So, it says go to dashboard. Click on the go to dashboard. For time being, you can have any configuration. So, right now, I'm putting in company as my configuration. I will select next. In the company, I will... And I say save configurations. If you don't want to have configuration, it is okay. You can have it later. So later on, if you want, I can edit configuration. Year, class, division, department, level, sub-level, location. So I'll take you through the entire dashboard and tell you how it works. So first of all, after coming here, we'll go to manage packages. Okay. And we'll say buy package, where you have to buy the 15,000 assessment pack. That then you get the 10 test licenses. Okay. Am I fast or is it?
No, ma'am. It's fine.
Yeah. So when you say buy now, you have to fill in the name of the organization. So I'll put in Brainberg, I will put my contact number. I will put the address and the GST number. And you can either pay offline or online, anything. Now that we are giving you 10 licenses as free, so you can opt for any kind of payment. Okay.
Basically, if we do not have any GST numbers, then what to enter?
You can put in any dummy GST number as well. So you can find it on the Google.
Okay.
Yeah, or you can even have this GST number which I have put. This is a dummy GST number.
Okay.
Okay. And say, just a second. There are a lot. I have done this so many times. So give me a moment. Yeah. So your order is placed, payment pending. This is the message you will get. Okay. As we are not paying right now, so once this is done, let me know from the back end. I will approve your packages. Okay. So right now I will stop the share, and from the back end I'll approve my own package. Okay. Hello.
Okay, Purva.
Yeah. Just give me a minute. Yes. So I have approved it from the backend. Now you can see the test licenses. Can everybody see the test licenses? These are the test licenses, unique IDs basically. So I have got total of 10. Is everyone with me? Hello?
Yes.
Understood?
Yes.
Any doubt in any step, what you have to do is when you buy a package for this buy now, you fill in all the details, you go for offline, online, whichever payment you want to. And after that, you let me know your the order ID. Okay, order ID. Once I get your order ID from the back end, I will approve the pack of 10. Okay. And as I approve it, these unique IDs will be reflected in your dashboard. Understood the step?
Yes.
Okay. After this, let's see how to assign a test to someone else. So, for example, now I have to give this test for myself. Okay. So I will put in my name, my email ID, my phone number. I will select the company. Again, one important point is that you cannot send any test until and unless you have a configuration. That's why I have kept company as a minor configuration. Okay, you can add on a lot of configurations, but you need to have one, at least one configuration to send the test. Okay. So I select Brainberg as the company and I say update. Once the subject details are updated, it goes into the ready section. So you can see this is new, this is ready. In the ready, you will see all the details, right? The unique ID, the number, the email address. Here, you have to assign the test. So I am assigning myself aptitude and career interest test because that is what we are dealing with. So I am assigning aptitude and career interest test. Test assigned successfully. As and when you assign the test, it goes into ready to share. So here again, if you feel that you have selected wrong test, you can again reassign the test for yourself or somebody else. If you feel the details are not appropriate, you can again edit it through this pencil sign. So this is the edit sign. You can again edit the details over here. Okay. And then you can say send. So whenever you send, you can either send it through SMS or email. So I will send it through email. As I send it through email, it goes into the sent option. Is everybody with me? Understood till here?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. So in the sent, again, we have given an option of re-editing the subject details. So sometimes it happens that you forget to put something or the email ID is wrong. You understand it later on. Oh, I have put in .in but not .com, or maybe there was a spelling mistake in gmail.com or something else, whatever the reason is. So you can re-edit the subject details and send it again on the email or SMS, whichever is convenient. Now, as you send this, you will get a notify in your mail. So you can you see this notify is ready at whiskwiz.com in your mail. So I had sent this link from the dashboard and I have got it here. So as soon as you click on the button below, you can start the test. Okay, so here I click and this is under maintenance. It will come in like 5 minutes every evening. The site goes under maintenance, but this is how we do it. Understood? Everybody understood?
Yes.
Yes. Sign up in the upper corner on right hand side, right? Yes. Yes, Shravani. Okay. So as you have created this, as I start my test, okay, the subject details goes into in progress section. And in progress, you can see the person has started the test and the person is giving the test. Once the person gives the test, it goes into completed section. Okay. And in the completed section, you will be able to view the report as well as send the report. So let me just see if I can show you that option as well. Just give me a moment. Also, after signing up, you don't have to constantly sign up. You can go to login directly on the WhizQuiz, login into corporate account. Put your phone number and the password. So here you can see, can you see the reports, the view report and the send report option? Can everybody see this?
Yes.
Yeah, the same functionality will be provided. It will appear here once the test is completed. Okay. So here you'll be able to see the detailed report and you'll be able to see the executive summary. I will tell you what is detailed report and executive report. This is, I'm just giving you a brief. And you'll be able to send either the detailed report, executive report, or both. Okay. So right now it is in sent as I have not completed the test, but once it is in completed, you will be able to see this. Okay. Now, more features of the dashboard are when you go to your profile. in my profile. You can update your profile over here. So you can upload any logo. You can upload your company's logo. Okay. And upload report logo. So this upload logo will come on the test screen, and upload report on the report. So as I show you this, so this is a report logo, TradeFit report logo. Brainberg is the site's logo. So here you will have this quiz logo. Instead of Brainberg, you'll have this quiz logo. Okay. So even if you want to have any other, like your own photo or your company's photo, you can put in here. You can even put in, upload it here. Then coming to address, then you have to say update now. You have updated. Now coming to edit configuration here, these are comma separated values. So say you're giving the test to say first standard, second standard, or say 8th standard, 9th standard, and 10th standard students. So you can write 8th, comma 9th, comma 10th. You don't have to put in space, you just have to put in comma, comma, and select the year so that the configuration gets selected. Class, again, 8th, 9th, 10th, any which ways. Division, A, B, C, D, whatever you want. Department, you can have, say, HR department or anything. Level would be one. So in level, you have to put in integers only, that is the numbers. So level is required when, you know, there are, if you're dealing with officers and engineers and sub-engineers, etc. Again, sub-level is the sub-level of the level. Location, if you're dealing with two or more locations, say Pune, Mumbai, Bangalore, so you will have to put Pune, comma, Mumbai, etc. And you have to select the location as well. Company, I have already selected. So institute, if you're dealing with institute people, you can put it institute as well. And when you say submit details, it gets successfully updated. So this is how the dashboard works. Understood?
Can you explain me why we need to input this configuration? Means what is the use of it?
Yeah.
Is
so
it going to appear on the report or like that? Means what it is for?
Yeah. So configuration, as I said, at least one configuration you need to have. You don't need to have all the configurations. Why it is necessary is because it will reflect. Just a second, I'll show you where it is reflecting here. Okay, and it is a distinguishing factor, you can say. So if you're dealing with 2-3 more companies, okay, and if you don't have any configuration, you won't be able to distinguish that Purva is from Brainberg only and not from some other company, or maybe division, or maybe okay. Standard, you know. So this is for distinguishing people, and this is for your ease itself. So you should easily identify, okay, Purva is from Brainberg, or Purva is from 8th standard, or XYZ is from, say, 2015 batch. Okay, that's why we need to have at least one configuration. Okay. And this is for corporate dashboard. As we are dealing with corporate dashboard, we need to have a configuration. Because when it comes to corporate dashboard, you are dealing not just with yourself, but other people also, right? Have I answered your question?
Yes, yes.
Yes. So is the process and everything understood?
Yes, so now as I'm able to log in now and registration mm-hmm. is done. So mm-hmm. now how to get the packages now? Do we need to click on buy packages or like that?
Yes. So as I said, in manage packages, you have to click on buy package. Here you can see two options, 5 assessment pack and 10 assessment pack. You have to buy the 10 assessment pack, that is 15,000 rupees.
Okay.
When you click on buy package, you can fill in all the details and you can say offline payment. Okay. After filling in, you will get this order ID, order number basically, 576. So yours would be maybe 577. Ishika, were you able to do it? Smriti, is it happening with yours?
Yes, yes.
Yes.
Okay. So just let me know your order IDs. I will approve it right now itself. Hello.
Yes.
Ishika and Smriti, can you tell me your order ID? Have you gone through it?
I did go through it, but I'm not sure which one is the order ID.
Just a second. I'll show you again. So this is the order ID you will find. Can you see it on the screen?
Yes.
Have you filled in all the details or you want to do it?
It is giving wrong GST number. Wait, GST number we need to add.
Yeah. May I?
Yeah.
It's 577.
Right. Just give me a minute. I'll approve it from backend.
Okay.
$577, right?
Yeah, $577.
Yes. Yes. Can you refresh your dashboard? Just
refresh
it. And you'll be able to see the unique IDs.
Yeah. Yes.
Great.
Yes, got it. Yeah.
Purva, I'm stuck up with GST only. Can you type it in chat box if it's possible for you?
Yeah, just a second. I'll have to see this.
Can I suggest something?
Yes, please.
So you on the Google, if you type dummy GST number, you will get many options. So you can just copy paste that.
I will just do it.
Or else you can type this.
Shall I help you?
Yeah, please.
I'll type in the message.
Yes,
I'll do that.
Yeah. Thank you, Smriti.
You're welcome.
Yes. Again, there are a few more features of import subject and export all subjects, which is required if you have a lot many of data. But right now, as we are dealing with only 10 licenses, these functionalities are not that important. Okay. So I'll just
tell you. You can please check.
Yes, thank you so much.
Yeah. Ishika, are you able to do this?
Yeah, I'm doing it.
Right. Yes.
Purva, I'm typing my order number.
Okay.
Thank you, Smriti. It worked.
Yeah, 578.
Yeah, I'm glad.
578. Yeah, you can now refresh the dashboard.
Yes, it is showing.
Yes, you got 10 licenses, right? Yeah, and Ishika?
Yeah, I'm done with that.
Okay, can you tell me your order ID?
I can't find the order ID. Where will I get it?
In the manage packages, you'll see this order 576.
Okay.
The order number.
Okay, yeah, 579.
579, all right. Yeah, you can now refresh the dashboard.
Yeah.
Yeah, you got it?
Yeah, I got it.
Yeah. So I'll just again give you a quick briefing so that now you have your licenses, a quick briefing, and then we'll go for report reading. I'll read the report for you. So for new, so for editing the subject details, you have to put in the name, email address, mobile number. So I have added these configurations. You can add whichever configuration you want.
Purva, what is the subject means? Name of a person you are saying?
Yeah, yeah. Subject okay, means okay. Name of the person. Yes. Okay. Then you update it. Once the subject information is updated, it goes into the ready. In ready, you assign the test of, say, aptitude and career interest test. As the test gets assigned, you go to ready to share. From the ready to share, you can reassign the test or you can re-edit the person's details. Okay, now I'll be sending email to myself. So this will again go into my email box. And you can see that it is now reflecting here. Two of them are reflecting here. As and when I start giving the test, it goes into in progress section. As we complete the test, it goes into completed section. And as I showed you for the trade fit, this will be the same for the WhizQuiz. Here you will get two, what you can say, tabs. Your send report detailed and executive, view report detailed and executive. Understood? And here in my profile, you can change your whatever, if you want to change your email or phone number or anything. If you want to upload your own logo or anything. If you want to even update your password, so you can change password from here. You have to put in old, new, and confirm, and it is changed. Again, this you can edit configurations. These are comma separated values. So put in a comma every time you put in a new value to any of the configuration. Say submit details, and the details will be successfully updated. Is the flow understood how it works?
Yes.
Yeah, understood. New to ready, ready to share, sent, in progress, and completed. This is the flow. Okay. In every tab, you will get this search button. So if you are confused, how should I search so many people? So you can just put in someone's name and the options will appear, the choices will appear over here. So you can easily navigate through all the people. Okay. So is there any question regarding dashboard?
No.
Anyone like Smriti, Ishika, others?
No.
No? Okay, so should we move on to report explanation?
Yes, please.
Okay, okay. Just give me a minute. I will... I'm stopping the share and I'm opening my report. Just a second. So, can you see the report? Hello?
Yes.
Yeah, yeah. So, this is a sample report. You will get similar kind of reports when somebody finishes aptitude and career interest test. So while reading any report, the important point first is to check the demographics. The person has put in proper age, occupation or student and the education. So sometimes what happens is students are say from 11th or 12th standard and they put in the education as only secondary. They don't put in higher secondary. Or sometimes they are graduates and they put in higher secondary. So we need to make sure that you have to tell the person that put in all the demographic details correctly. Occupation will be student, age 16.
If someone enters this education wrong, okay, or by mistake age wrong. So in this case, obviously report will change, right?
Yeah, it will
so in this
have...
case, what can we do?
Yeah, so it will have impact on the report. So you can let me know. I can then change it from the back end. So if the age is by mistake, you put something else. So I can rectify it from the back end. So most of the time it doesn't happen. But if it's a rare case, people do put in correct age range. But if in a rare case, you can contact me anytime. I'll help you out there. Okay. Yes. And while reading the report, you need to tell them why demographics are important. So this is basically a cohort, the gender, occupation, age, education. Why I'm saying this as a cohort, that a female of 16 years will be compared to a group of females who are 16 years of age, who are student and who are in higher secondary. So the basic question students might have that how are the scores calculated? We don't know how the scores came over here. So here you have to answer them that we did statistical analysis based on whatever information you have given. That is female, 16, student and higher secondary. So as sir told you, like the norms, he explained the norms, the reliability and the validity is different. It is regarding the test. When it comes to norms, these are the norms we are keeping in our mind for the test. So we have around 5 norms: gender, occupation, age, education, and country. And why norms are required? A person is compared to the similar norm group, to the similar norm group of, say, females of 16 age group with occupation student and education higher secondary and country India. And that is how our scores are reflecting in the report. Understood the demographics and the norms part?
Yes.
Yes. So this is where you need to tell them. This is very important. The demographics is very, very important. After that, coming to test details, you can see the date. You can see the start time. You can see the end time. Now, the major thing to look here is for the response style. So the response style should always be genuine. If there's anything else than genuine, the report cannot be considered. So what can be here will be some person might give answers carelessly. So the response style will reflect as careless. The response style might reflect as central tendency. Central tendency is the tendency of a student to answer in the sometimes that is the center options. So we have a scale of say 5 scales, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and the person always selects 3, 3, 3, 3, 3, 3. And hence, the response style is central tendency. And then there's another response style, which is acquiescence, where the person constantly responds in extremes. So either he selects 1 or he selects 5, 1 or 5. There is no consideration of second option, third option, fourth option. He only considers first option and the last option. So in such cases, the report cannot be considered for further analysis or maybe for further career counseling. Okay, the response style has to be genuine. Understood till here? Any issues?
No.
Okay. This is a disclaimer part where we are telling them that this test is kind of a supplementary to other data like performance appraisal or actual experience or personality preferences, motivation, and etc. And authors and distributors cannot accept responsibility for decisions made. So you can go through this disclaimer as well. Okay, so whenever you're telling, so this is not mandatory to tell your client because they are going to be the students. But if someone asks you, so you need to know the disclaimer points. So this is confidential assessment report. Okay, and we are keeping this as a supplementary part. So this should always go with the marks of the person, or there could be other techniques to assess someone's abilities, you know, academic performance, then interview, etc., etc. So this is one of the tools that we are using. Okay, disclaimer is done. Then the guide on using this report. So in this here, you can see what kind of skills we are majoring. Numerical ability, clerical ability, verbal ability, reasoning, spatial, mechanical, and closure. And in personality, we are measuring career interest. Okay, so these are nothing but they talk about WISC-WIS assessments. Going down, this is again, as I told you, the norms were used to generate the report. This is the norm group, the cohort. Then understanding charts and tables. So this is the NDC, normal distribution curve. This is again very technical, very statistical. So the only thing to consider over here is the strength score. If anybody asks you what is Z score, what is percentile and standard deviation, that is SD. So you need to tell them that these are the derived scores. These are the derived scores which are derived after statistical analysis. Statistical analysis of your raw score. Okay, understood? You can see the definitions as well over here. What is a Z score? What is percentile score? But here we are considering only strength score. Coming to response style, genuine. So as I said, it should be sufficiently varied in manner. The responses should be sufficiently varied in manner. Social desirability. So our system also measures social desirability. Where a person answers in a typical socially desirable manner. So for example, if you ask someone straight away that do you cheat? The person will say no. Why? Because it is not socially desirable. So when a person is doing that, our system can identify it. Coming to central tendency, if more than 60% of the questions are answered as neither agree nor disagree, that is, as I said, the middle options only, third. So neither agree nor disagree, the third option. And the acquiescence is constant extreme options, like strongly disagree and strongly agree. So this also we can see in the report. Coming to numerical ability, when you're reading the report, you have to tell them the definition of numerical ability. What definition in the sense, what we are measuring, what kind of numerical ability we are measuring in this test, their strength score, and the impression and where they stand. So here you can see numerical ability is 4.96. Okay, the strength score is 4.96, which falls between 4 to 6, that is average. Okay, and the impression is thus fairly recommended. Why fairly recommended? This ability is fairly recommended means that this ability can be taken into consideration and can be improved upon. Okay? Understood till here? Any doubts?
No.
Yeah.
No.
And numerical ability is nothing but the manipulation of numbers quickly and accurately with addition, subtraction, multiplication, and division. With that, we have interpretation and analysis. What is interpretation analysis? It is the meaning of the score. So what my score means, if someone asks, what is 4.96 mean? So you need to tell them that it means that your basic skills, so identifying and understanding numbers, is average. This is what your score means. Your computational skills, ability to perform arithmetical operations, is again average. Coming to self-help guide is nothing but self-improvement techniques. So here we are providing them certain tips, certain small techniques that they can use and they can improve their whichever ability, say numerical ability. So, but while having career counseling, you should have in hand certain quick tips and techniques. So nobody is going to read, or you are not going to read each and every word, right? Isn't it? Hello?
Yeah, right.
Yeah, so in summary, you have to have those 2-3 techniques in hand and you have to tell them, ki, Baba, you have to you need to have habit of practicing numerical ability questions, how you can do that, how you can plan for that. So you need to have those techniques in hand. Don't go on reading each and every word because it will take a lot of time. Okay. Coming to mentor's guide is basically for the parents, for the teachers, or whoever the mentors are. There could be school counselors, there could be educational counselors, there could be, say, tuition teachers who want to, you know, help the child improve on certain abilities. So this is for them. So while having career counseling, and if there are parents in front of you, you can again summarize this entire mentor's guide, have 2-3 techniques in hand that you can tell to their parents. Okay. This is very directive. Techniques are very directive. Okay. Coming to clerical ability, same. I'll go through faster because we are running out of time. Do let me know if anything I should highlight. verbal ability again, the understanding of comprehension of words and ideas. Coming to reasoning ability, the induction and deduction process, logical thinking. Then coming to spatial ability, the understanding of space around us, the patterns, objects, etc. Mechanical ability, the understanding of mechanical principles, machines, tools, etc. Coming to closure, where you need for the entire stimulus where the parts are missing. So this ability is majorly used by investigators, by detectives, you know, IPS, IS officers. So that was our abilities section. Coming to career interest. Career interest is very different from ability. Career interest is basically the liking. What kind of a personality I have and what, you know, what I like to do. So ability is something that I'm able to do. But interest is something that I like. So a little bit of emotional component comes over here. Okay. So in this report, you can see top three interests. We give top three interests, art, commerce, science, art, commerce, social science, from the this pool of interest, social science interest, home science, science, agriculture, sports, art, commerce, and realistic. Okay. And here you can see again, see the 8.33 strength score. So this is the overall overall strength score, the average score. Okay. Do I need to go into this, Priyanka ma'am? Like understanding of the interest and everything?
I think so. They would benefit in brief about each of the abilities. Some of them you've covered. Like they need to have an understanding why, like Vishal has covered what aptitude is. However, you know, if they can understand each of the aptitudes a little bit in detail, it'll help them.
Okay.
So not the later part of what is mentioned in the report, but just about what the aptitude and why we measure that particular aptitude. How does it relate to the child choosing a particular career option later in relation to whatever is highlighted in the report?
Yeah. Yeah, like I just wanted to ask, do I have to go deep into making them understand what social science interest is and everything? Because the time is running fast.
Yeah, but I think...
Hello, hello. May I come in? Sorry.
Yes, sir.
Sorry for my being not present here. I had to rest for a couple of engagement. So I was just hearing about the last couple of interjections made by Purva. You're asking about the description of what should be explained in this context, right?
Yes, sir.
And you've gone thoroughly through the entire ability part, right?
Yeah.
And you've also put in the aspects relating to the correlation between ability and aptitude. Attitude, the interest, and then coming down to the recommendation.
I have to go to career recommendation.
Okay, so what we'll do is Purva, this is an expansion of the, you know, Indian, not an Indian per se, I would say a little bit tweaking of the Holland's code. This will need some time to explain. Okay.
Yeah.
And I will want to explain it. Because this forms one of the crux of the attitude base, basis of finding the career. And then I'll also put forth the correlation matrix for the recommendation. But I'll just want to understand, they've made their own dashboards?
Yes, so they have made, they have ordered the package and they have got the licenses as well.
I just want to understand from Maitri and Smriti, you are able to log into your dashboards?
Yes,
sir.
You are able to know the process, how it works and everything?
Yes. Yeah.
Perfect. So next thing that we are going to do is, as of now, we will be able to, because you, before we end up into the understanding of how it correlates, you today will be able to use one of the license from the dashboard. As of now, we'll replenish it later in your dashboard, but use the process to initiate and send a link to your own email, get the test done maybe by tomorrow afternoon, and see the report for yourself. If any problem arises, you can ask me tomorrow. What I can do is, before we start tomorrow's session, I'll be able to run you through these two important aspects of the career interest and the recommendation section.
Sir, which test you want us to appear for?
Aptitude and career interest. Aptitude and career interest, primarily. Okay, this is the same test that the report that you're looking at. Good. So far, if you have known the dashboard, login and the sending of links and the reading the report. Any questions here?
No, sir.
If you face any technical problem also, you'll be able to reach me out at any point of time. You have my number, right?
No, sir.
You don't have my, I'll be sharing the number with you. I'll get your numbers from Priyanka and I'll be able to share it with you. So that will help you to immediately resolve the challenges coming up with the dashboard and related queries. Okay. Smruti, yes. I hope Ishika,
yes, sir,
rest of you works for you. Right. So what we'll do is, it's 6:06. We have run through a good chunk of understanding of psychometrics today. A relatively good understanding of the utility of WhizQuiz assessments. I would want you to, for some time from now, there'll be a downtime on the system. You may be able to face some challenges, but don't worry. The downtime will be rectified in the next half an hour to 45 minutes or 1 hour maximum. We'll be able to log in after that. Okay, so don't worry if you face like a downtime on the server. We are just having a routine workup on the server. So whenever you log in, you will be able to practice the sending of the links. Don't worry about like if you're exhausting a license there for your utility, we'll replenish the license for you. If you use 3-4 license in practice, we'll replenish it for you in the coming days to come. Okay, fine. I think that will work. So I think it's good for today. I mean, good food for thought. We'll be coming back tomorrow with more demonstrative cases about how to go about the counseling and explaining the report and everything. Fine. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Bye.